Sharma, Marine Engineering Faculty with Amit University. Today we'll discuss about refrigeration and air conditioning system on the ship. Refrigeration and air conditioning system is maintaining temperature in one or variable chambers at the required temperature. Like for example, in a refrigeration system, meat room and fish room are maintained at around minus 20 degrees. And dairy products and vegetable rooms are maintained as +10 degrees. Air conditioning system is used to maintain a comfortable environment in the accommodation. The system maintains a controlled temperature by compressing the refrigerant gas in a compressor, cooling the pressurized gas in a condenser. For cooling, we can use either seawater or fresh water. The high pressure liquid is expanded in a thermostatic expansion valve and passed through the evaporator where the heat from the surroundings is absorbed. So when the heat from the surrounding is absorbed, the temperature of that chamber reduces. So as discussed, we have the refrigeration system comprising of the compressor, the condenser, the thermostatic expansion valve and the evaporator. The HP and LP control and HP cutout are fitted on the compressor, which provides safety, which we will discuss later. The condenser can also act as a receiver where the liquid gas is stored before it is going to the thermostatic expansion valve. Before it reaches the thermostatic expansion valve, it passes through a dryer, which is normally a silica gel compound kept in a container, and silica gel will absorb the moisture. And from there it passes on to the solenoid valve, which is the main control, which prevents flooding of gas into the evaporator. The thermostatic expansion valve takes a feedback from the gas outlet of the evaporator, and accordingly it admits gas into the evaporator. If the temperature is quite low, it will stop the flow of gas through the evaporator. The evaporator consists of finned tubes which have fins on the outer side of the tube to increase the surface area for a better heat transfer. The basic components of any refrigeration system, which we have seen in the previous slide, is compressor, condenser, expansion valve, evaporator, and the refrigerant fluid, which is alternatively vaporized and liquefied during the refrigeration cycle. The temperature at which a fluid boils or condenses is known as the saturation temperature, and it varies with pressure. The compressor in a refrigeration system raises the pressure of the vaporized refrigerant, causing its saturation temperature to rise so that it is higher than that of the cooling medium. The compressor also promotes circulation. Due to the pressure it is developing, it will allow the gas to flow through the entire system and return back to the compressor as gas. Next, we will discuss about each and every component or each and every machinery involved in the refrigeration cycle. The refrigeration compressors are normally V-type compressors, which are cooled, lubricated by a special kind of lube oil, which has got anti-freezing properties. Normally, they consist of four chambers, and these compressor units have plate type suction and discharge valves. To reduce the load, normally in air conditioning systems, as the vessel enters a cold climate, we don't require much cooling in the system. So we can unload or take out one or two or three units depending upon the maker's suggestion by deactivating what is called as unloader valve. This is the valve, and the unloading device will just lift the delivery valve and keep it open. So practically there is no compression going on in that particular unit. So the efficiency of the compressor drops by 25%. From the compressor, the air, the gas passes through the oil separator. There is slight amount of oil carryover along with the gas from the compressor, because the compressor has got a trunk type piston and the crankcase is not completely isolated from the chamber. So that we cannot avoid the lube oil carryover along with the gas. And this lube oil carryover also acts as a lubrication for the piston rings and liner. So this gas passes through the oil separator, coming from the compressor, passes through the oil separator, which consists of baffle plates now, and the gas is made to change direction of flow rapidly at the end of this tube. So what happens is, due to the velocity of the gas, the oil is not able to flow along with the gas and it gets collected at the bottom, and once it activates the float, it is taken back to the compressor. So the next part is the condenser. The condenser liquefies the compressed gas which is coming from the compressor through the oil separator, and this is cooled by seawater or fresh water in case of a central cooling system. This is basically most of the condensers used in refrigeration and air conditioning systems are shell and tube type, which has got a side glass to make out the level of the condenser. The condenser liquefies the refrigerant by cooling it to below the saturation temperature. The pressure developed in the compressor is still maintained in the condenser, but only due to the cooling medium, the heat is given away and the refrigerant gas liquefies. Latent heat originally from the evaporator is transferred to the cooling water. The liquid refrigerant still at pressure produced by compressor is stored in the condenser, which also doubles up as the reservoir. As we saw in the previous line diagram, on marine systems, we do not have a separate receiver. The condenser also adds up as the receiver. From the condenser, the gas is led to the dryer before it reaches the thermostatic expansion valve. The main function of dryer is to remove the moisture from the refrigerant. Moisture in the system can cause blockage in the pipes and adversely affect the performance of the system. If there is a moisture at the thermostatic expansion valve when the gas expands and temperature drops, there are chances of this moisture going and solidifying and blocking the openings of the thermostatic expansion valve. So the dryer element consists of either a cartridge filter or a chamber containing silica gel. The silica gel has to be renewed once in 6 months, depending upon the performance. The next part is the thermostatic expansion valve, which forms the backbone of the system. The thermostatic expansion valve controls the quantity of gas passing through the evaporator. For example, suppose the temperature of meat room is reached minus 18. Further passage of gas into the evaporator there is not going to be any heat exchange. Further heat exchange, and there are chances of the refrigerant reaching the compressor in the liquid form. This causes damage to the compressor. So the main function of thermostatic expansion valve is regulate the flow of gas through the evaporator depending upon the temperature required. The thermostatic expansion valve takes a feedback from a bulb which is placed in contact with the evaporator outlet valve. Depending upon the temperature of this gas, the sensor will operate the thermostatic expansion valve and allow the gas to pass accordingly. From the thermostatic expansion valve, the gas passes through the evaporator. The refrigerant enters the evaporator at a temperature lower than that of the surroundings. The evaporator, as discussed, consists of tubes through which the gas passes, and there are fins fitted on the tubes, just similar to the radiator of a car. And these fins help in better heat transfer between the gas and the air. Normally, in refrigeration or AC systems, there is a forced draft fan which forces air to pass through the tubes the gas passing through the tubes and the air passing in between the tubes on the outer side assist in cooling the temperature of the chamber. Due to this heat exchange, when there is heat exchange, when the gas flowing into the inside the tubes absorb heat from the chamber, they boil off. The refrigerant leaves the evaporator as superheated gas. The back pressure valve is fitted on the outlet side of the wedge room. Now, the return from the evaporator of each and every chamber, like meat, fish and wedge, they come and join in a common manifold before they are passed on to the compressor. Now, since the temperature of the wedge room is maintained at a higher level compared to meat and fish, the amount of gas flowing through the wedge room will be less compared to that in the fish and meat room. On the return manifold, similarly, if the pressure of the gas is more, there are chances that these gas will enter into the wedge room evaporator coil and affecting the refrigerant, cooling of that chamber. So, we have a back pressure valve, which is basically a non-return valve, which prevents flow of gas and from the meat and fish into the wedge room evaporator. Now, coming to the air conditioning system, as we have seen earlier in the earlier slide, the air conditioning system is used for maintaining a comfortable temperature in the accommodation. The most preferable and comfortable temperature for human conditions is around 22 to 24 degrees centigrade. Now, in the air conditioning system, apart from cooling, we have provisions for heating the air in the accommodation with use of steam. When the vessel reaches cold climates or in sub-zero temperatures, we cannot run the air conditioning system to provide further cooling because it is not possible. We will have that problem of liquid coming back to the filling up the compressor and damage, and all those associated problems are there. So what normal practice is, as the ambient temperature reaches below 20 degrees, the air conditioning plant or the compressor is switched off and the gas is packed in the condenser. When we reach further lower climates, we can use the steam generated in the boiler to pass through the tubes, similar to what we saw in the evaporator. So there will be two evaporator coils, one for air conditioning and one for heating. So steam is passed through the pipes in the evaporator and the air is passing through the gaps. And so there is a amount of heating done for the air. The components and working of the air conditioning system is same as the refrigerant. The working principle is same and the capacity of the evaporator and blower is greater than that of the refrigeration plant. So there are some basic properties of the refrigerant and lube oil for the system to work satisfactorily. The refrigerant should boil off or evaporate at a low temperature and reasonable pressure and condense at a temperature near the normal sea level, seawater temperature. Seawater temperature varies from 30 degrees to say 24 degrees. Below 24 degrees, most probably the AC system will be off. But for refrigeration, the plant has to keep continuously running. So the refrigerant must also be free from toxic, explosive, flammable and corrosive properties. Due to manhandling, the operator should not have the hazard of inhaling the fumes. Traditional air conditioning and refrigeration plants used ammonia or CO2, which have all the desirable properties, but since they were hazardous, their use was discontinued quite long back. The CO2 and ammonia were later replaced by R22, which are HCFC based refrigerants. HCFC has a ozone depleting property. So these refrigerants were also discontinued, and presently we are using refrigerant 404A, which they have replaced HCFC gases. These do not have ozone depleting properties, but they are possible greenhouse gases. Next, we see about two important procedures or two important terms which we often encounter in refrigeration systems. One is subcooling. It is On vessel, a refrigeration plant will have a compressor in the engine room. The condenser and compressor is placed in the engine room, whereas the evaporator is placed somewhere in the accommodation, maybe one or two decks higher. Similar with air conditioning system also. So, to help the refrigerant reach up to the thermostatic expansion valve, which is fitted just at the inlet of the evaporator coil, the temperature of the refrigerant is reduced well below the saturation temperature. So, it ensures that the liquid does not boil till it reaches the thermostatic expansion valve. It will absorb slight amount of heat, but that heat is not sufficient to vaporize it. Superheating. The superheating is a phenomenon, subcooling is achieved in the condenser. The superheating. In the evaporator, the liquid refrigerant normally vaporizes entirely. The liquid is vaporized at low temperatures as the cold vapors flow through the evaporator coil. It continues to absorb heat and becomes superheated. As the vapor becomes superheated, it absorbs sensible heat in the evaporator, and this also ensures that no liquid reaches the compressor. This is where the thermostatic expansion valve plays a very important role. Next, we see as an operator what are the daily checks and what are the parameters which are to be observed on a refrigeration plant. The first thing and most important thing is the oil level in the compressor. There are chances as the oil carries over, and if the oil separator is not working properly, the oil is not going to come back to the crankcase and we might have low level and possible damage to the bearings. Compressor suction discharge valve lube oil pressures. So this is compression and compressor suction pressure and discharge pressure and the lube oil pressure. The lube oil and discharge are shown in a same compound gauge. The next point to be noted is level of liquid refrigerant in the condenser. Motor and amperage and the belt drive. The compressor, refrigerant and air conditioning compressors are normally driven by a motor with a belt. They are not directly coupled due to fluctuating loads acting on the compressor. The motor amperage and the belt drive ensure that all the belts are sufficiently tight. A slack belt will cause the compressor to slip and reduce the efficiency. The next point, most important, is temperatures being maintained in the chambers. Make sure that there is no icing on the evaporator coils, and drain the condensate water from the evaporator coil and close the tray. Below the refrigeration chambers, below the evaporator of refrigeration chambers, there is a tray which will collect the condensate water, whatever is forming because of the cooling. We have to keep it drained, and otherwise it will choke. It will solidify, it will become ice and choke the tray. And ensure there is no abnormal noise or vibration in the machinery. After the daily checks, we come to what has to be done in periodically, maybe once in a month or once in 3 months, once in 6 months. Tightness of the belt, apart from the visual inspection, stop the compressor and press the belt and check how much it is pressing. Evaporator filters and fins should be cleaned at least once in a month. In case of air conditioning system, as the vessel goes to places where there are a lot of dust in the atmosphere, there are chances that all the dust will be sucked by the fan and they get lodged in the evaporator fins. So in those cases, the cleaning should be more frequent. The safety alarms and trips are to be tried out on a monthly basis. Fortnightly leak test using soap solution or gas detector is done to ensure that there is no leakage in the system, visible areas of the system. So these, where are the visible areas? If we check, they are on the valves, the shaft seal, pipe connections, and evaporator, compressor, and condenser. The condenser seawater tubes, if it is a seawater cooled condenser, due to the ports calling or due to the condition of the water outside, there are chances that the tubes might get choked, and this reduces the efficiency of the condenser. And if the condenser is not cooling the gas remains in the receiver as a in the vapor form, and this reduces the efficiency of the system. The blower and compressor motors are normally overhauled during dry docking, as we cannot afford to stop the air conditioning plants, which are equipped with only one fan and a motor. We normally carry out in the dry dock. Next we discuss about the safeties fitted on the refrigeration plant. The one is low pressure cutout. Low pressure on the suction side will make the compressor cutout, preventing it from running dry. This happens when the thermostatic expansion valve closes and reduces and stops the flow of gas. So there is no gas coming back to the compressor, and this will reduce the suction pressure of the compressor, causing it to stop. As the gas starts coming and the pressure on the suction side builds up, the compressor will automatically cut in. This has no alarm, and this is a normal procedure that happens. High pressure trip. The trip is activated when there is an abnormal rise in the discharge pressure. This trips the compressor and gives an audiovisual alarm. So when you get this will be shown as a refrigeration system or air conditioning system abnormal. So once you have and you check that the high pressure trip, the most common reason for a high pressure trip is choked condenser, and also is some blockage in the pipeline after the condenser. Next is oil differential pressure trip. As we saw in the previous slide, the high pressure discharge, the discharge pressure and the oil lube oil pressure are shown in the same gauge. So if the temperature difference between the discharge pressure and the lube oil pressure is quite high, the compressor will trip on lube oil low pressure. Then there is a relief valve fitted on the condenser. In case the condenser is badly choked and the gas is not being cooled properly, it will cause the relief valve to lift, and the gas that is escaping from the condenser will be released in the atmosphere on the upper deck. Next we see what are the possible faults, what are and troubleshooting of those faults. So first is undercharging of the refrigeration system. Undercharging of the refrigeration system means the system has got less amount of gas. The quantity of gas in the system is less compared to what it has to be as prescribed by the maker. So if the gas in the system is less, the compressor runs hot and performance of the compressor falls. Suction and discharge pressure of the compressor is low. Large vapor bubbles in the liquid side class. Since there is no enough gas in the system and it is not being, the flow is not proper, you will have bubbles in the side glass. The condenser side glass will level will be very low. Then the ampere reading for the compressor motor is lower than normal. This means if the amount of gas passing through the compressor is less, the load on the compressor is less. So ultimately it shows on a, it displays a lower current on the motor. Due to insufficient gas, the cooling is not as required or as desired. So there is a rise in the temperature. And the desired temperature is not achieved, the compressor keeps running continuously. So in case of if we have any of these indications, the first thing we have to check is whether the gas has leaked from any point. And a leak test has to be carried out. We can use soap solution, or there is a electronic meter for that which senses the gas leakage. So we can check for gas leakage. Suppose the refrigeration charging has been carried out, has not been carried out for a very long time, or maybe 7 or 8 months, there has not been any charging of refrigerant. We can be assured that there is no leakage and it is a normal loss of gas due to continuous use. Similar to undercharging, what are the problems associated with overcharge of refrigeration in the system? The liquid level in the condenser is too high. High pressure switch of the compressor refrigerant compressor activates and stops the compressor. The suction and discharge pressures are high. There is sufficient the level of gas is more. So these are the problems. And It may be due to reason excessive refrigeration. Air in the system may also cause overcharging indication. Suppose the air is there, air has leaked into the system either while renewing the crankcase lube oil or during charging. This will also give symptoms of overcharging. But then with air in the system, the cooling of the plant is reduced. It may also be due to the formation of ice on the regulator. Moisture in the system. Moisture in the system is indicated by frosting in the line before the thermostatic expansion valve and a very high discharge pressure and low suction pressure. The moisture, as we saw earlier, will solidify and block the passage of the thermostatic expansion valve. So what happens is that discharge pressure of the compressor and the pressure of gas in the condenser will increase as the gas is not passing, but the compressor is continuously running. This is prevent the damage to the condenser or the evaporator is prevented by the LP cutout. Since the gas is not passing through the evaporator, there is less amount of gas reaching the compressor, and because of that the suction pressure drops, causing it to cut out at low pressure. We saw regarding moisture. Moisture can be prevented from entering the system using that silica gel. So once you have a traces of moisture and you get those associated problems, you have to change the silica gel or that filter cartridge. Next is oil in the refrigeration system. Temperatures of the compartment rises as the carried over oil insulates the coil. The oil being carried over along with the gas, they will form an insulating coating on the inner side of the tubes, which affects the heat transfer. It may cause excessive frosting on the suction line. As the heat transfer is not proper, the gas is not absorbing the heat, it will not be heated up. It doesn't become a superheated vapor. The compressor runs for an extended period of time as there is no proper heating and the cooling and the desired temperature is not achieved. The compressor keeps running continuously. The main indication is lubricating oil level in the compressor keeps dropping continuously. The refrigerant level in the condenser also falls. So the only remedy for oil carryover is you have to stop the system, pack the gas in the condenser and blow through the entire system with nitrogen or dry air. This is mostly carried out by shore technicians who have all the required equipments. If we have oil in the refrigeration system and we find all these symptoms, apart from removing the oil in the system, we also need to check the proper working of the oil separator. This thing is oil will also solidify in the coils and block the passage of gas, similar to what we saw in the moisture. The third problem we face in the refrigeration system is air. The compressor gets overheated and operates with a higher discharge pressure. Air bubbles in the liquid side glass of the condenser, and air in the system reduces the cooling capacity of the system, making the compressor to run for extended period of time. So here, from all these three problems, what we have seen is any drop in efficiency or any drop in efficiency due to any of these reasons, you will have a continuous operation of the compressor. So it is very important for the watchkeeper to monitor the running hours of the compressor and the temperatures being maintained continuously. The compressor gets overheated as we can understand, as we know, air doesn't have a lower boiling and evaporation and condensing temperature. So it is not going to condense, it is just going to pass as a gas even in the condenser. And because of this, air mixed with the refrigeration gas or refrigerant, the heat transfer is less, affecting the overall efficiency of the system. Another problem associated with the refrigeration plant is compressor tripping on high discharge pressure. We have already discussed that the main reason for high pressure trip on the compressor is a clogged condenser and improper seawater, insufficient seawater passing through the tubes and affecting the condensing of the gas. So in case of high pressure discharge trip, what we normally do is we close the discharge valve of the condenser and keep running the plant. the plant, the compressor will keep sucking the gas, whatever is there in the system, and just pack it into the condenser. Once there is no gas on the suction side, the compressor will not cut in, will not run, and then you can close the suction and discharge sides of the compressor and the suction side of the condenser and carry out the cleaning manually. So this is a brief explanation about a refrigeration and air conditioning system. Hope we have covered all the possible topics in this, and hope it is useful.